Proverbs 18 and verse 21.
Proverbs 18, 21.
Life and death are in the power.
Death and life.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue.
The tongue has the power of life and death.
Death or life
are in the power of your tongue.
What's up, y'all? So I am super excited because today we are starting a new segment of videos on this channel entitled, What Does This Verse Mean? So whenever you come across a verse in the Bible and you are confused about what that verse means, do me a favor and drop it in the comment section of this video or any video for that matter. And as I go through the comment section and I see that verse, I will do my best in a future video to answer that question and help bring some clarity on what that Bible verse actually means. So today we're looking at Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21, a very familiar verse of scripture where it says, the power of life and death is in the tongue. And so sometimes you'll hear somebody, normally from the Word of Faith camp, and they will use this verse and they'll say, the power of life and death is in the tongue. And so, you know, because God used the tongue to create, then God has given us the ability to create, and it's all in your tongue, and you can create, and you can create, speak life and all that stuff, right? But is that really what this verse is actually talking about? I don't believe so. So in this video, I'm gonna give you some ways that you can use your tongue for death. And I'm also gonna show you some ways that you can use your tongue for life. And then more importantly, towards the end of this video, I'm gonna give you three basic, solid biblical principles for how you can conduct yourself and use your tongue for the glory of God. All right, let's jump in. So one of the ways that you can speak death into such a situation and use your tongue in a negative way is criticism. And this is whenever you and I use our mouth to focus specifically on the faults and the failures and the shortcomings of someone else. Number two is discouragement. And this is whenever we use our tongues to try to remove courage in somebody so that they don't have what they need in terms of courage to step out and fulfill God's purpose or plan for their lives, no matter what that might be. Number three is gossip. And this is typically whenever somebody has shared some information to us privately. They have not given us the right to share that with anyone else, but we take it upon ourselves to share that information that was shared with us in secrecy with someone else. You know, the Bible has a lot to say about that in the book of Proverbs, where it says, a gossip goes around telling secrets, but those who are trustworthy can keep a confidence. The fourth way that we can speak death into a situation is through slander. And this is whenever we seek to defame someone else's character or their name by spreading false information about them. And number five is rage. And this is whenever we express our emotions with outbursts of anger. You know, Paul mentions this in a list of sins that we need to avoid that demonstrate that you and I are living in the flesh. Notice he says this in Galatians. He says, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, and here it is, outbursts of anger. So if you want to know whether you're living in the flesh or not, check how often you use your tongue as a way of expressing outbursts of anger. Now remember, the verse says that the power of life and death is in the tongue. So you can either use your tongue to destroy, or you can use your tongue to speak life into a situation. And so let me give you three quick ways on how you can do that. Number one is the opposite of discouragement, which is encouragement. And this is whenever we use our tongues to build people up and to remind them of what God's plan is for their life, so that now we're not removing courage for them, we're actually infusing courage in this person to fulfill God's plan and purpose for their life. The second way that we can speak life into a situation is through intercessory prayer. And this is whenever we take the time to either pray for, or better yet, pray with somebody so that they can hear us speak and pray the promises of God over their life. And then a third way that you can speak life into somebody's situation is through knowledge. And this is whenever we share our wisdom, our experiences, and our advice, hopefully from a godly biblical perspective, to help somebody make a decision that would honor God. Now, with all of that being said, let me give you three guiding principles that should always remain in your mind as you are seeking to try to tame your tongue, control your mouth, and essentially use it for the glory of God. Principle number one is to speak slowly. In other words, whenever we are communicating with someone, oftentimes we get in trouble whenever we speak too fast, whenever we don't think before we speak. James reminds us of this, and he says this: "Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger." So James reminds us that in the heat of discussion, whenever you are upset, whether you're frustrated, whether you're arguing with somebody, just remember at all times to speak slowly, because the slower you speak, the more you will think before you speak. Principle number two is not only speak slowly, but speak truthfully. All right? Because sometimes whenever we are in the heat of battle, we're not necessarily speaking truth. We're speaking how we feel about something, but it may or may not actually be what is true in that specific instance. Paul once again reminds us here in Ephesians, and he says, "Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another." That word falsehood is the Greek word pseudos, from which we get our English word pseudonym, or fake, or phony. And this is reminding us that whenever we are speaking, we need to make sure that whatever we're saying is truth. So not only should we speak slowly, and not only should we speak truthfully, but number three, we should speak graciously. Notice once again, Paul says this: "Let your conversation be gracious and attractive so that you will have the right response for everyone." Listen, oftentimes we might have the right words to say, but the tone in which we speak it and how we package it may be the very reason why people aren't receiving what we are trying to give them, because our conversation is not gracious and attractive. So if you are someone who struggles with your tone, just make sure that you allow this verse to check your heart at all times. Is my speech gracious? Is it attractive? Is it loving? Is it coming across in a way where people would actually want to receive it? So, my friends, this is video number one in our installment of what does this verse actually mean? So once again, if you have a verse where you're confused about what it might mean, drop it in the comment section below. And in a future video, I'll do my best to unpack that verse as best as I can and hopefully help you and many others understand what that verse actually means. Hey, I'll see you next time. Bye for now.